Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Second Chance Club, Hardship and Hope After Prison by Jason Hardy. Read by Jacques Roy.
For Kristen. Author's note. This is a work of nonfiction. I have described real people, but changed names and certain details. My accounts would fairly reflect any number of cases, in New Orleans and elsewhere, which is just to say that, as unsettling as much of this is, it happens every day. Introduction. The summer heat in New Orleans drove most drug dealers inside by noon. By 1 o'clock, only the addicts remained on the street, resigned to waiting for the market to reopen at dusk. The Landry brothers usually spent most of the day inside, but the air at their house was out. The two brothers and the three big dogs were seated on the front steps when I showed up. I was the probation and parole officer, the PO as we were known, to both brothers. I was new to the job, but probation and parole visits were old hat to the Landrys, and they let me know with a nod that they were in the middle of something and would be with me in a minute. Javaran, the older one, had just turned 30. He was short and stout like a college wrestler, with small, serious eyes. Ronald was as thin as a picket and covered in scars, incurred during the violent epileptic fits he'd been having since he was a teenager. Ronald was 25, but could have passed for 40. Both brothers had cigarettes lit and beer bottles in hand. Between sips and drags, they exchanged pages of a police report given to Ronald by his defense attorney. According to the report, Ronald had been the passenger in a car that was pulled over for speeding. Ronald and the driver had been drinking, and the car smelled like weed, which gave the police cause to conduct a search. The weed was already smoked, so the cops didn't find any. The cops weren't all that interested in weed anyway. They were looking for guns. They found one under the passenger's seat. The gun was registered to the driver's uncle, and the uncle had given the driver permission to take it. The driver had no permit. In Louisiana, that wasn't a serious problem, but when paired with alcohol, the gun became a misdemeanor offense for the driver. Ronald had 2 prior drug convictions and 1 prior gun conviction and was forbidden from being within arm's reach of a firearm. For Ronald, riding in a car with a gun in it was a felony. "You're sitting right on top of the motherfucker," Javaran said. "Can't believe they gave you bail." "The uncle came in and vouched for us," Ronald said. "He's got that big church on the West Bank." Javaran side-eyed his brother. "He's got votes is what he's got. Don't think those judges don't know it." Judicial allotments were pure luck. Political connections or not, there was only one judge in town that Javaran could see letting a probationer walk out of jail with a pending gun charge. 1 in 12 shot," Javaran said, "and you fucking hit." He laughed and raised his beer bottle to his brother's good fortune. "I didn't know he had a gun," Ronald told me. I told him I believed him. It was little consolation. A good report from a PO might convince a judge to go easy on a drug charge, but guns were another matter. Both Landrys knew it. Ronald was lucky to be free now, but he would likely lose his freedom when the case went to trial. Javaran wagged his beer bottle at me. "You want one?" Technically, probationers and parolees weren't supposed to be drinking, but no sensible PO bothered enforcing this restriction. "Little early for me," I said. "Let me do my thing and I'll get out of your hair." Javaran drained the beer bottle, flicked the cigarette into his overgrown yard, and led the way inside. It was a small 3-bedroom house, at most 1,200 square feet. The Landry's mother had the front bedroom. She was at work answering phones at a doctor's office. Neither of her sons was employed. Ronald's seizures had gotten him sent home from the few jobs he'd managed to get. Javaran had spent his 20s in and out of jail, mostly on felony charges related to his work for the local crack dealer, and he considered himself unemployable. I got the impression Javaran was more of an enforcer than a dealer, but he'd had a lot of product on him during his last arrest and was sent to prison. Most drug charges, like the one Ronald pleaded guilty to the year before, were resolved with probation. In other words, without jail. Javarin served the first 2 years of his 5-year sentence upstate in prison. As long as he didn't get in trouble again, he'd spend the next 3 years under my supervision on parole. In Louisiana, the probation rules and the parole rules were functionally identical. When conducting a home inspection, it wasn't necessary for me to remember which of the two forms of community supervision the guy I was visiting was on. Most POs referred to probationers and parolees collectively as offenders. The home inspection had two purposes, and even a rookie could see that they were an odd match. Purpose one was to look for contraband, drugs, guns, stolen property. If I found any, I was supposed to confiscate it, write a police report, and charge the offender with a crime. Purpose two was to make surface-level observations about the health, socioeconomic status, and pattern of life of the offender and the home's other residents, and to use the data to help the offender turn his life around. In simple terms, purpose one was to put the offender back in jail, purpose two was to keep him out. Most of the floor space in Javarin's room was occupied by rows of large black kennels. The three dogs I'd met outside on the steps were the product of a breeding tree Javarin had kept going for the better part of a decade, with Ronald stepping in to run things when Javarin was in jail. The bedrooms were small and clean, with twin beds and TVs on wicker nightstands. I spent no more than 5 seconds in each of the three bedrooms and another 5 in the kitchen and living room. It was all the time I needed. Home inspections were plain view only. I couldn't open closets or go into drawers unless I developed reasonable suspicion that something illegal was on the premises. Reasonable suspicion, sometimes referred to in law enforcement circles as an educated hunch, was easy enough for a PO to articulate. A long delay in opening the door during daylight hours, early mornings got you more leeway. An overly anxious or combative demeanor on the part of the offender, weed smoke, any of these could be cited in a police report as legal justification for a more thorough search. Quick, courteous inspections were a small but important way of showing offenders that I didn't want to put them in jail. I believed America should get out of the business of punishing people because they had a drug problem, or because they were broke, or because our city's failing schools hadn't prepared them for college or employment. I'd found this job during a late-night internet dive into the topic of mass incarceration. The third or fourth mass incarceration article mentioned probation and parole as part of the problem and, potentially, part of the solution. Most of the articles critical of probation and parole as institutions argued that offenders were set up to fail. POs asked too much of them and tried to solve every problem with jail. The answer seemed obvious enough. If reasonable people filled PO positions, outcomes would improve. It didn't occur to me, or as far as I could tell to most of the people weighing in on probation and parole matters on the internet, that POs used jail because jail was the only tool they had. It was all taxpayers were willing to spend money on. It's not hard to understand why. Most people see jail as an investment in public safety. When we think about public safety, we don't think about the costs. As soon as incarcerated people are released, we tend to reclassify them as receivers of social services. Investing in them stops feeling like investing in a less violent, less addicted America. It feels like a handout for people who probably don't deserve it. During my 4 years as a PO, I learned that deserving really has nothing to do with it. Probationers and parolees who go without housing, health care, drug treatment, and reliable income reoffend at alarming rates. Offenders paired with services tailored to their needs suffer fewer relapses and go back to jail far less often. They cost taxpayers less money. Some become taxpayers themselves. There are about 4.5 million people on probation and parole in America, more than twice the jail population. For most of my time as a PO, my caseload contained more than 200 offenders. It would be impossible to include all of their stories here. Reporting on only the hardest cases would give a false impression of the pluck and resiliency I so often observed in the probation and parole population. Ultimately, I settled on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.